Welcome back. You're watching the Urban Debate on Mirror Now. I'm Faye D'Souza. Thank you for staying with us. Now, Samajwadi Party leader Azam Khan is in the news again for his controversial statements. This time, Azam Khan is in the line of fire for his insensitive remarks on the Bulandshahr rape case. To remind our viewers, in this particular rape case, a mother and her teenage daughter were gang-raped by highway robbers while their car was stopped on the highway. The Attorney General, K.K. Venugopal, is now seeking permission to prosecute for obstruction of justice. This is what the AG told the Supreme Court today. He said, if a person in a position of power can be held accountable for making public statements in a rape or a murder case which would impact the trial in process. Joining me now in the Urban Debate tonight is a very special guest, a senior and eminent lawyer, Mr. Harish Salve. Thank you for joining us on Mirror Now and speaking with us. Mr. Salve, for our audience's information, has agreed to file an application with the Supreme Court seeking the court's intervention to pass guidelines to ensure a person in power is held accountable for making public comments in matters that are sub judice, especially in cases of rape and murder. Mr. Salve, I want to appreciate the fact that you've decided to take this up. Tell us why you believe that this should in fact be a punishable offence.
Let's get a few things clearly understood. See, what has happened is he did make some insensitive statements, to put it very mildly. And when he did make those statements, I think the parents of the victim or somebody filed a petition in the Supreme Court asking for action against him. Now, that action was set on course. He then appeared in the Supreme Court. First, he pleaded his right to free speech. And then, of course, he apologized to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court requested Mr. Nariman to be in a micus, and the question arose about the right of free speech. And one day when submissions were being made, and the then Attorney General, the previous Attorney General, got up and said something which was frankly a little odd. He got up and said that the right to free speech included, Mr. Azam Khan had the right to free speech, and therefore there's nothing which could be done. And I happened to be sitting in court, and Justice Misra possibly saw me nodding very vigorously. So he, since it was a public cause, he asked me, and I said, look, first of all, free speech includes legitimate speech, and this is not speech at all. So he said, you also please join and assist us. And the question of law which we have framed, and I must say, it was a very pleasant change when Mr. Venugopal got up and said that he completely disagrees with the perception that this was any part of free speech. The issue which I have raised in the Supreme Court is of a somewhat different dimension, and that's again very important for all of us, seeing what's going on around us. And the issue which I have raised is that our constitutional framework of governance, which is called the Westminster form of democracy, pivots around collective responsibility of ministers. The division of work into departments is a matter of convenience, but each minister is collectively responsible to the House and to the people. Now, if that is so, when a minister makes a comment on a matter of government business, and investigating a crime is a matter of government business, he cannot say these are my private views. Anything which a minister says have to be taken to be views of the government. So now, that is the starting point, can you imagine? Does a minister have a right of free speech on which he can say that a particular allegation of an offense is a falsehood, it is a political endeavor, and can we really believe that when a minister says this, i.e. the government says this, you expect the policeman investigating this to be fair and impartial? And is this not a constitutional government interfering with the working of the constitution in a very sensitive area, the area of rule of law and criminal investigation? So this raises questions of far-reaching constitutional importance, and that is why the Supreme Court felt that this has to be heard by five judges. The current Attorney General said he thought these were very important issues. And when Mr. Nariman mentioned that this was no longer about Azam Khan, the Attorney General, that's in that context, Mr. Venugopal said there is no question of exoneration, he has to be prosecuted. So he, it's not that the Attorney General has sought leave to prosecute him. He has said that what he has said is a prosecutable offense because it is obstruction in the course of justice. So these are all related constitutional issues, and we have increasingly seen people in power making all sorts of statements and then brushing them aside, saying, oh, those were his private views. Ministers who are holders of constitutional office and who owe collective responsibility cannot say, I'm the minister of Department X, I have a right to express private views about the Department Y. They can't do it. Ministers must speak for the government or hold their silence. And no right of free speech gives the minister a right to make private comments about government affairs. That's the constitution.
Mr. Salve, you're very right. And you know, for our viewers' benefit, I just want to remind our viewers, July 2014, Karnataka Chief Minister Siddaramaiah, on the rape of a six-year-old, asked the press, don't you have any other more important issue to focus on? Is this the only news you have? Mamata Banerjee, Chief Minister, and these are only Chief Ministers I'm quoting, Chief Minister of Bengal on the Park Street rape case said the entire matter had been cooked up. It was an attempt to malign the government. The Chief Minister of Haryana, Manohar Lal Khattar, said if a girl is dressed decently, a boy will not look at her the wrong way. If she really wants freedom, she should just roam about naked. This was said in response to a specific rape case. He also said, in response to a double murder and gang rape of two sisters, he said these are small issues. It could have happened anywhere in the country. When a journalist asked Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh, Akhilesh Yadav, at a press conference about the law and order situation, he shot back at her saying, I hope you have not faced any danger. Thank you. You should not propagate such lies. The Chief Minister of Himachal Pradesh, when coming under criticism for his statements in a particular rape case, he said these sort of incidents keep happening in society and should not be turned into a big deal. What sort of punishment are we looking for, Mr. Salve, in these cases, if you say it is obstruction of justice? And I've just called out not regular ministers, but chief ministers.
Let me tell you.
Yes. Yes, please go ahead.
Let me tell you the biggest... let me tell you what I, in my belief, would be the most effective deterrent. A holder of a constitutional office, if he commits such a serious breach of constitutional propriety and rule of law, that should be sufficient ground to remove him from office. When you become a minister, when you take any constitutional office, you take an oath to preserve and protect the Constitution. There are matters on which you may have a private opinion. If a chief minister feels that a media is being critical of the government in the manner in which it is dealing with the investigation into a gender offense or any offense or a communal offense, a caste offense, any of the socially sensitive areas of investigation, I can understand him saying, don't level false allegations. We are doing our best to investigate. But he cannot comment on the merits of the allegation. That's the job of the law enforcement department. That's the job of how people work a system. And as a constitutional functionary, you cannot say that I know the crime has been committed and it's under investigation, but I'm giving a clean chit. You have committed a constitutional illegality. And if today we not only recognize the rights of an accused, today we equally recognize the rights of a victim. Today, as a citizen of India, I am entitled that if there is an offense committed and I am a victim in any way, I am entitled to the full protection of the law, including justice in accordance with the law. And if a minister is interfering with that, he is committing a constitutional tort against me. A tort is a wrong. So he is committing a constitutional wrong against me. And if you holder of a constitutional office commits a constitutional wrong, it must have sanction. And that is where it is going to hurt. So until the courts crack down on this and lay down the law clearly, reminding those who are so keen to hold constitutional office, who aspire so deeply to hold constitutional office, that it is an office of responsibilities, not just perquisites.
Right. You know, Mr. Salve, while on behalf of the women of this country, I thank you for extending your experience and your expertise to this particular issue. I do want to ask you this. We have seen a lot of these insensitive statements being made when it comes to rape, when it comes to crime against women. Why do you think that members of government, inevitably in most cases male, in a couple of cases female as well, across all party lines, across all governments, seem to find, you know, claims or allegations of rape somehow soft targets for these sort of statements?
See, we must acknowledge the deep disconnect we have between the kind of value system which our constitution demands and the kind of value system we see in public office today. The Constitution demands a spirit of constitutional values within the people who aspire to hold constitutional office. Why do you swear to preserve and protect the Constitution when you do not believe in its values? People who get elected do not believe in those values. And that is why you see this deep disconnect between the constitutional compulsion of gender justice, the constitutional compulsion of, in fact, as they say, having laws favoring women to equalize. You must lean in favor of the weaker segment of society in order to level society. And if you do not commit to that philosophy of the Constitution, do not swear to uphold the Constitution. But we have people who take the oath to uphold the Constitution, but who in their heart don't believe in these values. And that is why, scratch the surface and the truth comes out. They have a very, very thin veneer, if at all, at times even that is missing, of sophistry and of constitutional seriousness. Scratch that and the truth comes out. Put them in a difficult situation and they start speaking their heart out. They are not willing to recognize that if there are problems in society, and there are problems in every society in the world, it's their job as defenders of the Constitution to make sure that those underlying social values which lead to these problems are done away with. Haven't we done away with untouchability? We've done away with untouchability. We made it a criminal offense, but you've also educated people that, look, untouchability is unacceptable in society. The same way we have to teach our children, our members of our family, of respect for women. Now, the trouble is those who come and aspire to hold these offices must be role models. They have to lead by example. But it's very obvious that they don't commit to these values in their own heart. So when people like you go and corner them in a difficult situation, you see these kind of utterances in which the truth, as they say, has a nasty habit of sneaking out.
Well, I also want to ask you, about, and you mentioned freedom of speech that caused you to really shake your head inside of court. There is the larger debate of how much freedom of speech really allows us and how responsible each of us needs to be when it comes to the utilization of that freedom and of that right. Do you believe, again, that this example, like you said, needs to start at the very top, which is every person who's holding office, whether that is a politician, whether that's a senior police officer, or a senior government officer, needs to be held accountable, needs to be taught the limitations or the responsibility they have when it comes to freedom of speech?
Look, can the army chief tell you what we are next planning to do on our borders, and if questioned, say, I have a right of free speech. He holds an office which puts him in a very responsible position. It's his duty to hold the confidence of what measures are being planned, which, if divulged, will compromise national security. Can a judge of the Supreme Court speak about an ongoing case? It's his freedom of speech. No. His office obliges him to behave in a particular fashion. A person who, and believe me, today a member of parliament, or more than him, a minister, whether of the state cabinet or the union cabinet, who is taken on to himself the solemn responsibility of preserving, protecting, and upholding the Constitution, cannot cite freedom of speech to make statements which are destructive of constitutional values. What freedom of speech are you talking about? Can a doctor say, I have a right to go free speech and divulge my patient's conditions? So in every situation in which we find ourselves, our job might require us to contain our speech. Freedom of speech doesn't mean the right to speak whatever you want, whenever you want. And if you hold these kind of values, if you feel that you must be free to speak and should not be constrained in your expression of opinion, do not join the government. Be a critic. Then advocate for whatever point of view you have in mind. But if you take a particular office, you have to respect that office and what comes with it. It's as simple as that.
Right. I also have one last question for you, out of curiosity. The co-warranto that actually questions the manner in which office is held, can it be extended in these particular cases, especially to do with chief ministers, to question how the office is being abused?
Well, let's take it a step at a time. If we can persuade the court to hold that statements which are so fundamentally opposed to our constitutional values and systems constitute what we call a constitutional tort, a constitutional wrong, then some sanction would follow. And one of them could be that he vacates office. If that's the law, you will see a freedom of speech being balanced perfectly and sensibly with official duties.
Well, Mr. Salve, also given our politicians' ability to sort of come back to power the next day, the next week, the next month, or perhaps the next year in the next election, would you also be seeking that the person be disqualified from that particular position or office for a certain time period?
Parliament should consider some sort of legislation. If we cross the first bridge and get the court to declare these are constitutional torts, then maybe public opinion can be mobilized to bring in much, much, much sorely needed electoral reforms. Tainted ministers, a person accused of committing a crime and a person accused of a serious constitutional tort should be treated on the same footing. Basically, you're telling somebody you're not fit to hold constitutional office. We will need a law for this. But public opinion will build step by step, and I'm sure if you carry this battle on, we will get there.
Well, Mr. Salve, thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate the effort you're putting in, the fact that you're lending your considerable expertise to this particular case. We wish you very, very good luck. And of course, we promise you on this channel that we will continue to fight for the responsible right of speech. We will continue to fight for the rights of women and for justice to be served. We're going to take a very quick break. We'll come back with an entire panel of guests to discuss this very point. Should ministers holding positions of power be held accountable for irresponsible statements that they make while police are investigating cases of rape? Should they be removed from office entirely? That's coming up on the other side. Don't go anywhere.
Samajwadi Party leader Azam Khan is in the news yet again for his controversial statements. This time, Azam Khan is in the line of fire for his insensitive remarks on the Bulandshahr gang rape. The Attorney General is now seeking his prosecution for obstructing justice.
Indeed, this is a matter which will assume a lot of criticality and import going forward, especially in the backdrop of the times that we are living in, where we see sometimes random statements being issued by politicians and those occupying constitutional posts, unmindful completely of the fact about the sensitive nature of the investigations which are underway, and completely also unmindful of the fact that they are holding important positions and each word or sentence that they utter can go on to impact the investigating officer.
The Supreme Court has indicated that the controversial neta will be issued a notice only after an application is filed in the case. Senior advocate Harish Salve has now intervened to pass guidelines to ensure a person in power is held accountable for making public comments in matters that are sub judice, especially in cases of rape and murder. With growing instances of netas making insensitive statements, we ask, is it time we have a law that ensures all netas making such remarks are brought to book? Mirror Now report.
We are watching the Urban Debate on Mirror Now. I'm Faye D'Souza. The question we are asking this evening, should politicians making comments be booked? Harish Salve was just with us. He was live. He was talking about the fact that anybody holding office, anybody who is a minister of the state or a union minister making an irresponsible, insensitive statement while an investigation is on, especially in the cases of rape. Incidentally, most of these irresponsible statements are made in the cases of rape. He said these people should be removed from office as punishment for misuse of that office, because when they make a statement, according to Mr. Salve, they influence the law enforcers, the police people who are investigating that case. And as a result, they're obstructing justice. I couldn't agree with him more as he takes that particular petition to the Supreme Court. But the question we're asking this evening, and I'm asking it of you viewers, is do you believe that these netas who make irresponsible statements when investigations are on should be removed from office? Joining me on the show this evening, Aman Sinha, spokesperson of the BJP. Juhie Singh, spokesperson of the Samajwadi Party. Sanjay Jha of the Congress Party. Justice Saldanha, former Chief Justice of the Bombay High Court. Ramakanth Gaur, senior lawyer at the Supreme Court. Brinda Adige is a women's rights activist. I welcome all of you to this conversation. For our viewers watching at home, you can join us on various ways. You can either post on Twitter or Facebook. Our phone lines are open, as well as use invol.in. That's going to pop up on your screen. All you have to do is log in and leave a message on invol.in. It'll pop up automatically on our screen. That's the quickest way to be part of the debate. Aman Sinha, spokesperson of the BJP. In this particular case, when we are talking about Azam Khan and the irresponsible statement he made in the investigation, do you believe that freedom of speech, which is the justification he offered the court, does that actually hold? Do you believe when someone like this is holding office, they should be barred or they should be removed from office completely?
Well, absolutely, and they have to be held accountable, especially our elected representatives. It is incumbent upon them to exercise all the more responsibility, discretion when they are saying something, especially when it comes to, cases where there is some criminal prosecution which is going on or investigation which is going on. But let me say, Faye, that the efforts of Mr. Harish Salve as amicus in this matter are truly commendable. He has himself volunteered to file an application to reopen the case and allow it to be investigated. And similarly, Attorney General for India Mr. K.K. Venugopal has made a passionate appeal to the Supreme Court that such people should not be let off the hook, and such people have to be held accountable. And he stated that Mr. Azam Khan, who's been a habitual offender and who's termed this gruesome rape and dacoity which took place in Bulandshahr as some kind of political conspiracy, nothing could be more shocking and unfortunate. And therefore, the Attorney General, Mr. K.K. Venugopal, made a passionate appeal to the Supreme Court, which was accepted by the court. And Mr. Harish Salve himself, as amicus in the matter, has volunteered to file an application seeking reopening of the case and investigation of this particular matter, because ingredients of a criminal offence are also constituted under section 186 of the IPC. The ingredients are fully met, and therefore the court will take a view on initiating investigation. And I think it is high time that our political representatives, our elected representatives, were held accountable not only for their actions but for what they speak, and their actions should not tantamount to jeopardizing any investigation or inquiry which is ongoing.
Right, let me bring in Juhie Singh, representing the Samajwadi Party here. Ms. Singh, thank you for joining us. Please tell us why you believe Azam Khan in this particular case should not be charged with obstruction of justice.
I think the Attorney General and Harish Salve ji have already petitioned to the court that to reopen the court, and I actually believe that not only just the elected representatives but anybody in the public domain, whether it's officials, whether it's the investigating officers, nobody should be allowed to make such remarks, insensitive remarks on such serious cases. And if a legislation comes across good enough, it should be applicable to all political parties, because this might be a case which has of course caught our eye, and we have already condemned this remark, but politicians at large have been, especially as you've mentioned earlier in the discussion I was hearing, especially in regards to crimes against women, it's become more of opportunity to talk about women and to really be insensitive on the matter, and that reflects badly on the society. But it involves just not politicians, even the officials, even people handling it, of course anybody who wants to even really get himself elected and occupy a public office, self-restraint should be there, and this should not be confused with any sort of freedom of speech, because the Constitution does not grant us freedom of speech on this ground, that one can speak whatever one wants and really demean women. Or also there are other issues also, caste, religion, division of India. So all these issues would of course come forward in this case, and I'm sure the Supreme Court will come up with the right directions. Which,
will, Ms. Singh, would you agree the same should also apply for a statement like ladke ladke hain, galti to ho jaati hai, boys will be boys, they're going to make mistakes?
I'll tell you, that particular statement was said in a context where he was talking about capital punishment. Now again, it is for a person to see that statement in a context, and whether it is right or wrong, it was said in a particular context, not really defending anybody. But the case is already in the Supreme Court. This particular case of politicians really being non-serious about such issues, so let the Supreme Court decide. And as a Samajwadi Party, we are not defending any such statements.
You are not defending the statement of ladke ladke hain, galti to ho jaati hai. I want to bring in Brinda Adige, and I completely agree with the opening statements of both Mr. Harish Salve and Aman Sinha when we talked about the fact that anyone who says derogatory, insensitive, misleading things about a case of rape or crime against women while the investigation is on must be removed from office. Brinda Adige.
I absolutely agree. They have to be barred, suspended, removed from office, because these are elected representatives. The citizens have elected them into power to uphold the constitution. So there is a value system because of which they have been elected. But these representatives absolutely need to know that these are the rights and entitlements of citizens, and especially women. Victim and witness protection, there is nothing like that in our country. Knowing all of this, these elected representatives have no job, no responsibility, and continue to speak like this, they cannot hold that office. And this responsibility also falls on the political parties. They cannot get away with it and say that we are now waiting for a law to come. These people should already have this built into their manifesto, that a member of their party behaving in such a callous, insensitive, irresponsible fashion will not be tolerated in that party. It should not be said that he said it out of context, he didn't mean what he was trying to say. All of these excuses are not accepted. Please remember that when you have taken up this public office, there is a decorum, and ethics that you have to follow. There is a professionalism. You are not here doing a duty, doing a favor to the citizens. You are doing a duty. You are being paid for it. And this means if you do not uphold that position, you are not fit to be in that position. You must be summarily removed.
Absolutely, summarily removed. Justice Saldanha. Justice Saldanha, I completely agree with the fact that we've been talking about this for so long on this channel. Irresponsible statements being made about victims, victim shaming, would actually mislead investigators. Do you believe that these people, these politicians, these netas should be prosecuted?
Faye, may I say something more than that?
Please go ahead.
To start with, please don't overlook the fact that any statement of this type is very, very damaging and prejudicial to the victim. The victims also have rights. They have a right not to be defamed. And they have a right also for redressal when offenses of this type take place. And a statement of this type virtually not only destroys the situation of that type, what happens is that it directly influences the investigating authorities, not to mention the courts. I know that a judge is not required, should never be prejudiced by irresponsible statements or things that happen. What about trial by media? There's one of these cases in Mumbai itself, where, to best of my knowledge, the manner in which the media has been carrying on, every conceivable statement has been made to condemn the accused. What is left for the court to do? Now, these are all issues which require to be seriously looked into, but I do agree, I fully support, I appreciate the fact that Mr. Salve and some of our best legal brains and the Supreme Court also has seriously applied their mind and that they are going to take this issue up. But that will take a little time. May I point out something else? The accused also has rights. And statements of this type, they interfere with the course of a judicial proceeding. Now, under the existing law, under the Contempt of Courts Act, any act, any statement, any words, anything done that influences or prejudices the judicial proceeding is actionable. A person can be convicted. But I do agree with what Mr. Salve has pointed out, that we require a more comprehensive law, a specific law. I agree completely with what he has said. And I do hope that at the earliest point of time, something like that will happen. But in the meantime, there are two things which I want to point out. The first is that for a very long time, particularly under the Contempt of Courts Act or in many other situations, when an apology is tendered, the matter is closed. Now, there are very valid reasons why courts often do that. But I've had instances, and there's been one of them, where despite an apology having been tendered, because the conduct was so contumacious and so gross, I had pointed out in my order, in the judgment, that the apology cannot and will not be accepted, and he was convicted. Now, in the present instance, I do believe that a politician or a person holding public office who makes a statement that is so damning and so defamatory and so harmful to the victim and to the investigation and to everything else cannot be allowed to get away even if he tenders an apology.
Yes. Let me bring in Sanjay Jha of the Congress Party. Sanjay Jha, do you agree that these people should be removed from office? And if you do agree, the July 2014 statement by Karnataka Chief Minister Siddaramaiah on the rape of a six-year-old girl, where he asked the media, don't you have any other issue to bring up? Is this the only news you have to talk about? Wouldn't you say that is irresponsible and misleading to suggest to the law enforcers that the rape of a six-year-old girl in the state of Karnataka is actually not important and shouldn't be focused upon? Shouldn't he be removed from office by this argument?
A very pertinent question, Faye, and I agree with you that in public life, one has to exercise a high degree of political propriety as well as moral rectitude. I don't think there can be any debate on it. You know, but it's interesting that while you were mentioning a laundry list of violations by different political leaders, and I think all of them, irrespective from which political party, need to take responsibility for making statements that can actually be contrary to ensuring correct justice. Don't forget what Mr. Arun Jaitley said after the ghastly Nirbhaya incident. He went publicly and said this was one small incident. I wish Mr. Arun Jaitley had resigned. Now, I can give you a whole list of issues made by different politicians. But, you know, one of them that comes to mind, and it is linked, well, it is a ghastly death again of Pehlu Khan in the Alwar lynching. And you had Mukhtar Abbas Naqvi of this government in parliament saying the incident never happened. Now, is not that an obstruction of justice? So I do believe that end of day, whether it's Mr. Arun Jaitley or whether it's any other leader from any party, they need to exercise restraint without doubt. Now, the point I'm going to make here is I agree with the gentleman who said some time ago that each and every political party needs to have a very high standard of, you know, ethical conduct for its members. And without waiting for a litigation to happen in court or without waiting for a media, you know, trial and tribulation to put people through the coal fires, the party should voluntarily, very spontaneously take action on its own. But, you know, you have to ultimately nail the issue where it matters. And I'll give you one example of it. You know, we are all very apathetic. You know, everyone starts celebrating a win. Nobody questions Sanjay what Jha, happens to
you,
the political party.
So you agree that the Karnataka Chief Minister Siddaramaiah's statement on the rape of a six-year-old girl was in fact obstruction of justice? Do you agree, yes or no?
Well, I can tell you it is reprehensible without doubt, as is Mr. Arun Jaitley's statement, as is Mohan Bhagwat's statement saying that rapes only
as
happen in the
As is KJ George, former Karnataka Home Minister, who says, how can you call it gang rape? A gang rape is when four or five people are involved.
He has been making a lot of incorrect statements.
Dharamveer Goyat of the Haryana Congress Committee said 90% of the rape cases are consensual.
Himself needs to
Mr. Botsa Satyanarayan of the Indian National Congress said just because India achieved freedom at midnight doesn't mean women can venture out after dark. Would you condemn all of these statements, Sanjay Jha?
Right. I condemn Faye, all of it, and since you seem to be particularly relishing what misdemeanors were made or stated by the Congress leaders, let me tell you what Kailash Vijay Bargia said. He said sexual harassment is all about Sita Haran. Ramesh Bias, the chief whip in the Lok Sabha, approved. The BJP leader
Please
said
do not concord
okay.
and manufacture.
Rupa Ganguly of the BJP said, and said in 15 days a woman let's not make this about the political system.
Party,
I think we all know
seems to be coming
all political
out here.
Parties make a mistake. But Faye, the larger point
that is, what you
is
are
in
making
Mr. Modi's
political.
Cabinet, Faye, 31% of the cabinet members have criminal charges. Let's look into those issues. And Nitish Kumar's cabinet, 22 out of 29 cabinet ministers have criminal
Let me allow Aman Sinha to come in. Aman Sinha, I also want to show you.
At best, there are only political charges of political agitation.
Can you deny what Arun Jaitley said?
It's very unfortunate that the Congress spokespersons, they come and they come on a debate.
No, we need to put discussions in perspective.
Restraint and they themselves.
I apologize, will you?
Such a blatant manner.
I apologize for my party leaders saying anything
inappropriate.
Will you apologize for Arun Jaitley's statement?
Now I do not wish to get into a slanging match with Mr.
Gentlemen, if you speak at the same time, my audience cannot understand you. One at a time, please.
Who've been making irresponsible statements, not only on women issues, not only on rape, on army, on terrorism. I do not even wish to flag it.
Oh, really?
There are numerous such instances. But what is this debate leading to?
Do I need to tell you what the BJP leader said after the Rohtak incident?
Okay. If somebody Congress can party, get raped,
what can
they do? Instead of introspecting and putting their own house in order,
that is how callous you were.
Look at the state
that
of Congress party.
That is how callous you were.
Today they are reducing
the right, gentlemen, you're both talking at the same time. I cannot understand you.
If the rape happens, what can we do?
And may I just come back to the moot point that you were making? The stand of the government is clearly reflected in the arguments which have been made by Attorney General for India, and he clearly said that there is no place for such indiscretion in public life, and people who are there in elected offices, they have to exercise more restraint and discretion. Their such statements are going to, you know, subvert the investigative process,
okay.
The prosecutions which are going on.
Thank you. Mr. Sinha, I have a follow-up question for you.
Supreme Court. And I do not know what Mr. Sanjay Jha is saying. Sometimes Mr. Sanjay Jha does not realize the words that are uttered out of his mouth.
Okay, Mr. Sinha, Mr. Aman Sinha, spokesperson of the BJP, I have a question you, if I may.
I think you better think about
Haryana Chief Minister Manohar Lal Khattar, in a case of a double murder, gentlemen, please. In a case of Haryana Chief Minister Manohar Lal Khattar, in a case of a double murder and the gang rape of two sisters and the police raids over allegation of beef being used in biryani in Mewat, said such small issues happen all the time. They can happen anywhere in the country. The same Chief Minister, Mr. Khattar, also said, if a girl is dressed decently, a boy will not look at her the wrong way. If you want freedom, why don't you just roam around naked? Freedom has to be limited. The short clothes are Western influences. These were said in reactions to rape cases that were currently being investigated at that time. Would you agree that this particular application also applies in these two cases?
Well, Faye, first of all, I seriously doubt that this was the exact content and tone and tenor of the statement. And Mr. Khattar, he usually gives statements in Hindi. But whatever, you know, be the context, you know, if there is any impropriety which has happened anywhere, we absolutely, you know, we acknowledge and we admit it. And this is what, you know, even if there were any instances of any BJP functionary behaving or, you know, being, you know, having any kind of improper conduct or making any indiscretion, at the first earliest opportunity is apologized. And, you know, the party has also sensitized him. And let me say that in Haryana, the girl sex ratio has drastically improved. Look at the results that the government is delivering. It has come up from somewhere in 800s to higher 900s. And so there is remarkable progress. The real test lies in actions, and if you see the results which are coming through, large number of BJP states which are there, and Haryana was a state where the gender ratio was abysmal, and when Mr. Sanjay Jha's party government was
okay, fair enough. That's a fair point to make. But let me also point out to the fact that there were several newspapers that reported that the Haryana sex ratio was being exaggerated and was not exactly what was on the ground. There was a newspaper report that suggested that the Haryana sex ratio had been exaggerated by the government to seem better than the real situation. But I want to bring in Ramakanth Gaur. Ramakanth Gaur, one of the applications requests, and we asked this.
I do not know about any such report, but I am only quoting official data, and I can tell you that there has been substantial improvement, and I'm sure you would also agree with that, Faye.
Okay, all right. I want to bring in Ramakanth Gaur. Ramakanth Gaur, one of the demands, Mr. Salve just spoke with us.
Cases against women?
Mr. Salve, we'll get that data. My team is just digging up a comparative data of what the state of Haryana is like in comparison to other states when it comes to crime against women. We have been talking a lot about it on this channel. But Mr. Gaur, I'm coming back to you. One of the things that Mr. Salve is going to seek from the Supreme Court is that this person or whichever person is holding office makes a statement like this be removed from office. Do you believe that these individuals should also be barred from returning to the same office for a certain period of time? Because we've seen our politicians make remarkable comebacks, sometimes in less than 24 hours.
Undoubtedly, Faye. These persons should not only be removed, but also be barred for some time to contest the elections. And since Congress is here, BJP is here, and they both are fighting over the issues. But one of the points on which they are agreeing that this is something which is bad. May I request them to promise this here, that they'll make this insensitivity or atrocious kind of statement to be a prosecutable offense? Because we lack the specific law in this regard. So though Supreme Court is undoubtedly taking care of this issue, but at the same time, we need a law to be enacted. So are they really willing to enact the law? One. Two, any offense, whether this is a rape offense or a murder offense or any other offense, these offenses are investigated by a sub-inspector or an inspector level officer. if such a such ranked politico or a minister or a chief minister makes a statement that there is no sanctity, or there is, or he ameliorates the sanctity, or the he comments on the merits of the case, then how can a sub inspector or inspector go beyond what his minister states? So this is simpliciter. Not only the interference in the administration of justice, but also it hampers the course of investigation.
Absolutely. And you know, while I'm calling out statements being made by various politicians, I wish we had a representative of the TMC from West Bengal on this panel as well. Because Mamata Banerjee, in reaction to the Park Street rape case, which was reported widely across the country, Brinda Adige said, this matter is being cooked up. It's an attempt to malign the state government. This is exactly the kind of thing Harish Salve is talking about. This is exactly the kind of thing that Azam Khan is standing in front of the High Court, Supreme Court, I beg your pardon, for. Every politician, or various politicians across various political lines, it seems like a very contagious disease.
It's not only a contagious disease, it is patriarchy that is so strongly instilled that this patriarchy does not have any gender, no religion, no creed, no caste, and no language. It's only power that is now being abused and misused. So when you're talking of Mamata Banerjee, it is the same. How to take charge and control of that chair and not let go of it, even in the face of making and telling a lie publicly, putting down that victim, that citizen whose vote brought that person up to this office. So it goes to show that these people do not respect the citizen nor the vote that was cast for this person. And that is why it is important that political parties put this as part of their agenda, their guideline, that all members must and should become sensitive, understand what the legislations are, what is the constitution, and how you respond when these cases come up. You respond in a manner that is respectful, you respond in a manner that is dignified, and at no point of time, without any excuse, not taking anything out of context and in context, will you make inappropriate, belittling that victim, that survivor. And when you have done something like this, the party should be the first one to say, we debar you and you cannot stand for the next election or for the next 5 years. It should be the party.
You know, Brinda,
first.
Brinda, that's an ideal. That's an ideal world. That's an ideal world. But it rarely happens. And I have this question right now for all three members of political parties. And like I said, I wish we had more people to represent political parties. But let me start with Juhie Singh. Juhie Singh, Abu Azmi of the Samajwadi Party is a repeat offender. Repeat offender. He has said things like, yes, if a woman is caught in a rape case, then both she and the boy should be punished. In India, there should be a death penalty for rape when there's consensual sex outside marriage. Why is there no death penalty against women? Now, my question to you is this. Why has the Samajwadi Party, yes, never removed one of these people or debarred one of these people from elections? Why do you continue to give them tickets? Why do you continue to give them positions of power? You keep saying that this sort of thing is regrettable, but you obviously do not regret enough. Have you? Can you give me a single example when one of these people have been removed from office?
I don't think any political party can give you a single example, because co-panelist mentioned, yes, most of the learned judge says most of these instances rightly just end in an apology. For most parties, yes, an ideal thing would be to have this internal sort of discipline to educate its people. The legislation is there, the enactment is there, and it's we who flout it. So yes, internal discipline should be there. And but I still feel that all parties have a majority of people who are aspiring towards this, and I hope it happens soon. And the fact that any such statements are now taken back up by a responsible channel like yours, they are pending in the Supreme Court. Most of these cases are taken to court, FIRs are registered. Of course, the law says that somebody has to put in an application. So there are people who are putting in. So yes, self-restraint for us and for all people in the public domain is important, and it's something we should all aspire for, is all I can say at the moment.
Well, Aman Sinha, do you have an example you can give us of the Bharatiya Janata Party that has ever removed a member of the party for making statements like this?
Well, Faye, you'll find very few Bharatiya Janata Party leaders or functionaries making any such statements. And let me tell you, Faye, that the maximum number of repeat offenders, you know, sometimes there is indiscretion and impropriety which people commit in public life and they immediately acknowledge and accept it and they have remorse for that. But, you know, let me say that Samajwadi Party has the maximum number of habitual offenders, so to speak. And Mr. Azam Khan, you know, the Mr. Mulayam Singh Yadav or, you know, other functionaries, I do not wish to go
Aman
into
Sinha,
details.
But
they are
that's
habitual offenders.
Statement.
And in fact, you know, this is what was stated also in Supreme
you don't
Court.
Want to
after
solve
expressing
this
remorse,
you are just
Mr. Azam
to,
Khan, after apologizing to Supreme Court,
oh, come
went on
Sinha,
again in a diatribe and
yourself.
Tried
when
to insult the Indian army.
This is a
he tried to say, you know, such insulting things and such demeaning things against Indian army. And therefore, the court had to take on this.
What is your reaction, Mr. Sinha? What is your reaction?
To
Mukhtar
Why
Abbas
are you interfering?
Naqvi.
I don't know.
Mr. Sinha, Mukhtar Abbas Naqvi of the BJP just last year said
yes.
Women wearing lipstick and powder are the same as terrorists.
Yes, he has been a
I'm
very
wearing lipstick and powder right now,
for
Mr. Sinha.
Large number of years.
And I don't recall Mr. Naqvi
Sorry,
tendering an apology
you.
To me.
Can you just repeat once?
My question to you is, and I will repeat it, Mukhtar Abbas Naqvi of the BJP just last year said women wearing lipstick and powder are the same as terrorists. I'm wearing lipstick and powder right now. I do not recall Mr. Naqvi ever tendering an apology to me.
No.
Me too.
Faye, I don't recall any such statement made by Mr. Naqvi. I think, there might be some miscommunication or something. I do not at all recall any such statement being made. But as I have said, even if there has been indiscretion, BJP has been first party to accept it. And, you know, if you wish to, you know, I if there has been any indiscretion, I tender an apology on behalf of, you know, my party or party functionaries, if at all there has been any indiscretion. But let me say that BJP is the party where you will find least number of functionaries or any individuals making any such statements, and the biggest, you know, party with, suspect persons is the Congress party, and Samajwadi party has the maximum number of habitual offenders.
Justice Saldanha, this is, you know, a low blow blame game.
Really revealing your patriarchal attitude by this absolute dishonesty on this panel, that the BJP does not
Mr. Sanjay Jha wants to be another habitual offender.
Absolutely. How duplicitous and dubious can the
Now you're sidelining the
Justice Saldanha, this is the problem actually that there isn't a single political party that can claim to never have done.
Hey, I think we are all unanimous about the fact that the damaging effects of statements of this type are so far-reaching that we need an immediate stop to be put to it. Now, how do we do it? My suggestion is very simple. When I was judge of the Karnataka High Court, there was a politician who was in the category of a habitual offender. And after warning him, I had passed an order, because the law does permit it, I had passed an order that he should be debarred from holding any public office for a period of 5 years. And to the best of my knowledge, that judgment was challenged in the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court upheld it. So the law does exist. I'm all in favor of something more comprehensive. But my further suggestion is this, that when these sort of atrocious situations come up day in and day out, the high courts do have the suo motu power to haul up the offender, to haul up the guilty party, hold an investigation and pass an order. Now, why is that not happening? I'd like to see that happen more often. Because if an example is made, I know that after that order was passed, all this irresponsible behavior in Karnataka stopped. And I do believe that even until something better is done, as a stopgap arrangement, the court should clamp down very heavily, haul up irresponsible people of this type, take action against them. And
right.
I'm firmly of the view that tendering an apology cannot undo the damage. I still remember in my lawyer days, there was a particular newspaper editor who used to habitually commit contempt of court. And it was a joke in the High Court that his name was listed in the Guinness Book of World Records for having tendered 494 apologies. And every time you would get away and repeat it.
So I understand what you're saying. And, you know, just for the benefit of the audience, the information that was requested on the crime rate in Haryana. Haryana comes in at number 4 in the country with 204 gang rapes registered in a year. Uttar Pradesh tops that list with 458, followed by Rajasthan with 411 in Madhya Pradesh with 270. Haryana also rates number 2 in the country, the second highest rate of dowry deaths per population of 1.9 lakh with 243 cases. That's data, that's government data. But I want to ask Sanjay Jha this question. Sanjay Jha, has the Congress party ever removed a politician from membership of the party for making an irresponsible statement? And has the party ever conducted a training session for your party politicians on what is responsible, what is not, and where their freedom of speech ends? If we're talking about being more responsible, have you ever done that?
Faye, I can tell you with full confidence that the latter has been done. I'll also be honest enough to tell you that I don't recollect anybody being, you know, maybe suspended, maybe. But if somebody has been removed from a position of power when they were in authority, I can't recollect one. And I will agree with you that the political system has failed in ensuring that the respect to the genders are kind of done in a very exemplary high standard. So there is no doubt about it. I'll also agree with you when you mentioned that data. Interestingly, anybody will observe all the states are BJP ruled, and that's a significant coincidence. But the last point is very relevant. I do believe that end of day, you know, I think the political system itself has to wake up, because
been
when you raise these
Congress
questions
party
to me, I'm biting the bullet here with you. I think the political party's reputation
suffers.
Please don't adopt your usual parliamentary tactics. Let me finish. So, Faye, let me tell you in brief, I do believe that the reputation of a political party suffers. I feel at the end of the day, each political party, if they have the prudence, they will recognize that this should not be the receiving end of such a debate. So at least on behalf of the Congress party, I can tell you this much for a fact, that we will do our level best to ensure that we are not at all ever held guilty of the kind of misdemeanors we have discussed today on your program.
You know, I have the same question, and I want to point out that in most corporate houses, including our own, we conduct extensive training sessions for all managers to tell them what is acceptable behavior, what is not acceptable behavior. Why don't political parties do the same? And if they are doing the same, Sanjay Jha, if you tell me that the Congress party has done so, then you seem to have left out particularly the ministers in Karnataka, because they are repeat offenders. Mr. Sinha, has the BJP ever conducted such a training session telling their ministers and people in power things that can and cannot be said?
Faye, I can tell you that we have, you know, a very comprehensive training program which goes on in our party. In fact, our party president, Amit Shah ji, has paid special emphasis to it. We have, you know, some of the institutions who are, you know, which are dedicatedly, you know, doing this particular job only. We have a dedicated department in the BJP for this. So therefore, there is indeed an effort. But considering the large number of, you know, members that we have around it, more than 11 crore membership of the party, obviously each and every individual, you know, it will take time for them to undergo these training sessions. But there is a clear intent and effort on part of the party that is one of the priorities of BJP President Mr. Amit Shah, and therefore we have dedicated department and dedicated institutions which are working, and they are designated for this purpose. And I can assure you that lakhs and crores of party workers have already undergone that training program.
Juhie Singh, same question to you. Does the Samajwadi Party take the rights of women seriously? Are you conducting training sessions, or are netas allowed to say whatever they want?
First of all, I think maybe I would just like to make a statement. The party workers or the party ministers of the BJP are not listening to Amit Shah in that particular department then. Because the statements really come out bizarre. Samajwadi Party is conducting such sessions, is sensitizing people, is trying to even internally, if any
worker or any of our leaders. To Amit Shah ji.
Well, if you're, you know, Juhie Singh, if you're conducting
please worry about your own
hosting these training sessions, may I recommend an extensive training session for Abu Azmi and Azam Khan?
Which side buying MLA's Yadav is bullying?
Which side Akhilesh Yadav is going on?
He's busy buying MLA's
complete United Front
under presidentship of Amit Shah Ji.
Sinha Ji, he's buying MLA's MLA ko khareed rahe hain.
If you speak over each other, we cannot understand you.
Amit Shah Ji, you have the MLA ko khareed rahe
hain. Please, please calm down. Your ministers make ridiculous statements. You said that the BJP doesn't make statements. You are the only one on this panel.
में जा रहे हैं कि आपको ऐसा पता चल रहा है क्या? बीजेपी किसी को नहीं खरीदती है, इतने लोग बीजेपी में आना चाहते हैं और बीजेपी अपना ये देख के उसे बात किसी को नहीं चाहिए।
Mr. Sinha needs to control his language. I don't know from where he gets it.
आया राम गया राम जो है तो कांग्रेस पार्टी का ही शुरू किया हुआ है ना?
Okay, to the politicians, we started off with a very respectful debate where we can hear each one of you. If you speak over each other, the audience cannot understand you, and we defeat the purpose of the time we are spending having this conversation. Juhie Singh, if you're telling me that the Samajwadi Party does extensive, training sessions for your politicians, may I recommend an even more extensive training session for Abu Azmi and Azam Khan, who seem to be in these cases regular offenders?
Special sessions.
Sessions for both of them. And I just want to point out to the politicians, obviously, if these training sessions will not work unless there is disciplinary action taken, and all three of you have confirmed that no disciplinary action has ever been taken against a member of a political party who has said disrespectful things about rape victims or rape cases. Joseph T. Lobo is on the phone line from Delhi. Joseph, go ahead. We can hear you.
No, that is not what I have said.
Good evening, Faye. I want to congratulate you on this movement that you have started. It is high time that these lip-talking politicians are made to bite the dust before the people who have elected them, and they have. And they are an absolute disgrace to our democracy that we hold so dear in our country. Carry on with the movement, please. All these people are worried about is their lal battis and bungalows, and they think they can shoot their mouths off brazenly. It is high time that they are brought to book. And I congratulate you once again for this movement that you have started.
Right. Thank you. Dev Kumar on the phone line from Coimbatore. Dev Kumar, go ahead.
Yeah, Faye, I am extremely grateful to you for having brought out this important subject on your channel. And it shames us, all of us, to see the politicians discuss the issues along party lines. Is there any party involved when the safety of our women is concerned? Are the women biased towards a particular party? The answer is no. And here we have somebody speaking up saying, I'm from the Congress, I did this, I did that. Or, saying that the ratio of women has increased or decreased. That is not relevant. What is relevant is, are our women safe in the country? And are these leaders doing enough to keep them safe? We have had instances where we have pulled up people who have made inflammatory speeches on communal lines. Why can't we also have similar law for people who make inflammatory speeches on gender bias?
And absolutely.
Our women folk.
Absolutely. And just to remind our viewers who might have just tuned in, the reason we're having this conversation is because Mr. Harish Salve will approach the Supreme Court asking that those politicians who are in positions of power who make disrespectful statements when rape cases are being investigated should be charged with obstruction of justice and should be removed from office. That's the question we're asking. Should we hold politicians responsible for what they say? Because when they're in office, they're speaking as someone who is holding public office. So the right to freedom of speech doesn't technically apply. Ramakanth Gaur, here's my question. Something very, very beautiful was said. Do women actually care about which political party? My submission is that women should care about which political party. Political parties should have training sessions. They should make sure that they're taking disciplinary action against those people who offend and say offensive and insensitive things. And women should then go out as 50% of the population of this country and vote for those political parties who actually walk the talk. Ramakanth Gaur.
See, Indian culture talks about yatra naryaste pujyante tatra ramante devata. Jahan nari matra ki puja hoti hai, wahan devata ka nivas hota hai. So, this is our culture. By heritage, we owe this and we need to follow that. But unfortunately, what we have seen in this debate is happening outside as well. No political party wants to listen to each other. They are happy to play the blame game. So it is for the women to now stand up for their own issues and tell these political parties that we exist. And we exist to the tune of, say, around 50%, and we matter a lot. Whosoever does not respect will have the humble pie. So the women have to stand up now. They have to tell these political parties, enough is enough. You have not given us respect. We command the love and respect. You, the men, are here on this planet just because of us. So if you don't take care about us, about our integrity, about our respect, then we'll take you to the task.
Well, you know, with all due respect, Ramakanth Gaur, what a terrible thing to have to say after 70 years of independence, that we have to make the men of this country aware of the fact that we are human beings who deserve equal rights. Justice Saldanha, this is such a disappointing thing for me to hear personally, that women of this country need to band together and remind the men of our existence. Is that really necessary?
Quite right, Faye, but the point is, I think that we require something to be done now that is anticipatory and preventive, because these statements are so very damaging that they disqualify the person who has made the statement from holding public office. There can't be two views about it. Now, action should be taken, and it should be taken straight away. We require to bring about more stringent laws, no doubt about that. But even under the existing laws, I'd like to see a couple of cases where deterrent action is taken. If a politician knows that when he makes a statement like this, he's going to be disqualified from office, he will certainly not do it, and neither will the others do it. We've had an example in Karnataka, and that's what I would like to see happening. I'd like to see the courts take suo moto action. They can do it every day. There's no problem about it.
Absolutely, and you know, we're getting calls right now from all over the country, but we're also getting calls from overseas. Suman Ghosh is on the phone line from Kenya, and he's called us live. Suman Ghosh, go ahead.
Good evening. I happen to see this channel, and it sounds very good that this type of movement is going on in the country. But unfortunately, what I am seeing, the ruling party spokesperson, Mr. Aman Sinha.
Yes.
Mr. Aman Sinha is taking a very high ground, that, and he apparently he is trying to have a race between the political parties, where who is more guilty than the other. Is it that race he is more interested on? Or he is interested on
removing
a problem which is existing in our country. He sounds idiotic, actually.
Let me first of all, Mr. Sinha, I'll come to you for this, but I just want to remind our viewers who are calling in, please be respectful of all of our panelists. They are here in their capacity as spokespeople. They've been chosen to represent the parties that they are part of. We also have members of senior members of the legal community and activists on this panel. We choose our panelists very carefully. I would request you, while all of your questions are important, to please afford them the respect that they deserve. Mr. Sinha, I know you want to respond to that. I have another question for you that's coming from Priyanka Das Gupta, and she says, when you promote Beti Bachao, Beti Padao, we also need to care for the safety of those Betis in society. She directed that question to you. Please go ahead.
Absolutely. The government is very conscious of its responsibilities, and this is one of the top priorities for the government. And that is the point that I was making, Faye, that there have been large number of, you know, law and order issues or women related issues in the past. Obviously, that is a legacy, which difficult legacy that we have to live with, and we have to try to improve upon that. Now, I do not know what the gentleman was saying on phone and what was his background, but let me say only this much, that the government is doing its utmost to see that all the women-related issues are properly addressed. Not only this, all our state governments and the government at center is also very sensitive and conscious to all the issues, you know, which are pertinent for our women folk. And they are as much, you know, equal part of the society as men folk are. So therefore, I do not wish to dwell more upon that. But the results speak for themselves, Faye. And if you pick up data from any of the BJP ruled states or even at the central level, you will find that on all women related issues and parameters, there has been significant improvement. Yeah, obviously, it's not a perfect world. There are large number of challenges and the government is doing its utmost to deal with those challenges. And the party is also very conscious and sensitive to these requirements. And we do our utmost. And Sanjay, if somebody wishes to criticize, they are free to do so. But there has to be some rational and logic.
Fair enough. Sanjay Jha, go ahead.
I want to make just one point. You know, governments make a mistake when they begin to believe that we live in an economy. We first live in a society. You know, we keep talking about GST and GDP and FDI and ease of doing business. But we don't live in a bubble. It's not just about being in an economic, you know, kind of situation. I mean, end of day, we live in a society, and therefore, nobody talks about Human Development Index. Do we ever have discussions? You do it, and a few others maybe, on gender disparity index, which is getting progressively worse. I'm not saying that only one government has to be blamed, but this is a societal failure. And therefore, I come back to the point that end of day, the priorities that we have need to change. And therefore, I think all political parties, and I'll agree with you, Faye, on that. Now, Mr. Sinha, kindly don't interrupt. I'm not making a petty political point here. I'm talking in a larger context. If you don't comprehend it, it's your problem. But Faye, answering you, I will make this point that I'm glad that you and a couple of others, thankfully, are trying to create a more, I would say, reasoned debate with a lot more nuance and with a lot more of a dispassionate panel. Why don't you learn to listen and respect people, my friend? I'm not talking to you alone. I'm talking to the other panelists. I'm talking to Faye. I'm talking to the viewers of the
channel.
Please,
I do not need to learn from you.
For God's sake, respect other people.
First, you need to learn.
The larger point I wish to make is, it is a problem that the political system needs to address.
Mr. Sanjay Jha is going to give all of us a preaching on how to respect others and have good manners.
I mean, this man is incredible. I mean, you're an incredible man. I mean, what kind of a party do you come
I'm running out of time. I'm running out of time. But I'm going to bring in Brinda Adige as a
speaker for other people. To listen to your personal remarks, Mr. Jha.
Please.
Brinda Adige.
Well, why don't you go and listen to Mr. Narendra Modi's
I apologize, Brinda Adige, that you had to hear that. I apologize to our viewers as well. I think this might be one of the problems, the fact that we just cannot see eye to eye and we expect Parliament to function in these cases. Brinda Adige, as the women's rights activist on the panel, I want to give you the last word. Go ahead.
We must realize all parties together, increasingly across our country, there is a narrative that is belittling women, violence against women, and also putting women out of the major portion of justice. We have also witnessed just now the 498A actually being diluted and including the NCW supporting it. So as political parties, we need to take it upon ourselves and yourself especially that dignity to women, respect to women, and rights of women to be free from any form of violence, right, and the laws to be helping them should be paramount. You cannot say that I am less bad than the other person. That doesn't make you any good. And we also have to tell ourselves that women are citizens in their own rights, and their votes are as important as male citizens. And even if the law is going to take a long time, already the judiciary needs to start working on it. And as political parties, you take the responsibility and set the precedent, probably BJP, set the precedent that we will debar, that you will suspend, and you will remove people from office if they are speaking in the manner that they are not supposed to on cases of this nature.
Very well said. I have a couple of people on the phone line. I want to hear them out. Archana on the phone line from Delhi. Archana, thank you for holding. Go ahead, Archana.
My only contention today in the debate is each of these politicians, whichever debate they go to, every debate eventually turns around and becomes about politics. And the whole central idea is lost because they start casting aspersions at each other. It is time that all political parties start looking within. The woman voter of this country is getting more and more intelligent every day. And we are sick and tired of them trying to digress from the core issue that is being discussed, and which is about that people within their parties are denigrating and causing a reduction in the kind of respect or that is to be given to women. They need to look within and stop casting aspersions at others and stop making every discussion about politics.
Yes.
People are getting intelligent.
Very well said. Very well said. Nelson on the phone line from Delhi. Nelson, go ahead.
It's unfortunate to hear all these statements. But the problem is it not? It is not politicians require a training session or anything. I don't agree with that. But the point is, leaders emerge in the family, leaders emerge in the classrooms and the universities, where we need a gender sensitization. The whole political statements regarding women reflects the primitive mindset which we need to thought, which we need to eliminate, and that can be eliminated only in the family setup, and where especially in the universities, in the curriculum, and the approach that we need, a modern trend. I think that's more important than anything else. Thank you.
All right. I want to thank our viewers for calling in. We've had such intelligent phone calls coming from across the country, intelligent voices that should be listened to. We have to wrap up this conversation. I thank our guests. But in conclusion, I must say this. Think about the things that the women have asked for on this panel tonight. Dignity, respect, and basic human rights. It's almost as if we are subhuman, uncitizens who do not matter, that our rights do not matter. The fact that we should be having this conversation at all, 70 years after our independence, so many years after the Constitution put it down in writing that we are equal in the eyes of the law, that we are still having to beg for basic human dignity, that somehow politicians across party lines, men and women across all governments of different states, find themselves constantly in a position to disregard and be insensitive about the rights of women, especially those who have suffered at the hands of rapists. These are the people we vote into power. I applaud Harish Salve for going forward and asking the Supreme Court that these people be removed from office. I ask him to take it one step further and insist that these people be debarred from entering that office for a certain period of time. To our viewers at home, perhaps as women, it's time for us to adopt a carrot and stick approach. Because obviously, as we have discovered on this panel, politicians are nowhere near self-regulation when it comes to these matters. Let us only reward those who take our rights seriously with votes. And if they don't take our rights seriously, then the no option is available to us. Nota is available to us. And the punishment, the stick, should be to report these people, to ban completely and avoid political parties that treat our rights like it is nothing. We look towards the wisdom of the Supreme Court right now to hold these people accountable, because they're obviously not going to hold themselves accountable. No political party has ever removed a member from a position of power for disrespecting women. It is time we stood up for our own rights. As nearly 50% of the population of this country, we have the power of votes. We are intelligent and we are impatient. And we will not give you another day to treat us badly. Enough is enough. It's time that you face the book. Thanks for watching.